Welcome back, and you are still on to Cosmopolitan Market on the Nigeria Customs Broadcasting Network. And just before the break, I said that on today's edition, we shall be speaking to issues around food inflation. And there is, of course, like I said earlier as well, the discussion as to whether Nigeria is in a food crisis or not. And we saw the inflation rate stand at 18.12% in the month of April, indicating the first decline in headline inflation in about 20 months. And that was according to the Consumer Price Index report. But closely watching the index, we also saw that food inflation for the month of April dropped to 22.95%. And it is higher than the rate we had seen in the month of March 2020. And joining me to discuss this issues now is Rabiu Tuko Hassan. He is an economist. Welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you for joining us. I believe it's only ideal that I start off with this. I came across a debate recently where there was an argument as to if inflation is structural and or whether it is transient or persistent. What would you say inflation is based on these parameters?
Thank you very much for being with me and for getting me on board. I want to suggest that one of the reasons for this development is both structural and seasonal, I should say. Don't forget that the nature and structure of rigidity in our economy, especially as it relates to variables that create inflation, can change from time to time. My understanding is that, especially given so much change, so much increases that the economy has witnessed in terms of cost of energy, cost of transportation, and various other inputs into the supply value chain, those have become very fundamental. But don't forget also, around this season, around the time when some of our agric output traders are depleting, it usually creates some pressure on the economy, on the sector, and that equally creates some level of inflation. However, looking backwards to the last 15 years or thereabouts, the numbers have never actually reached this point, and which is clearly suggesting that we need to be very cautious on the side of government and policy making. We need to be additionally cautious in terms of doing those combination of things that will actually create stability in the economy, and that will ultimately create to stable prices.
Mr. Rabiu, can you say that we are currently in a food crisis? Because there is the argument as to whether we are there yet, or there is still some hope at the end of the tunnel. Can we say, as we speak, that we are in a food crisis?
Yeah, there are a lot of existing and impending challenges in the economy. Nigeria is naturally endowed. There's no doubt about it. The geographic or climatic endowments are there. We have everything we need to produce. In fact, some parts of the country can produce for the whole year, throughout the year. And unfortunately, failure of policy, failure of the economy to galvanize all the resources together and then get to see us producing optimally. What I mean by optimally is doing everything we can do to produce from the available resources. Our failure as a nation to harness all the potentials and get to produce has actually remained one of the biggest challenges we are confronted with. And in the looking up into the horizon, yes, there are challenges, but I believe we will come to it, and we will be able to work towards getting a short-term solution, because most of our problems, if you look at them, are mostly problems that can be handled in the short term if all commitments and all hands are put on deck.
Mr. Rabiu, I like the fact that you spoke to how cautious we should be as a people right now. But speaking about the body language that we are seeing from those at the helm of affairs, do you think they understand how grim the situation is now?
Well, body language is something that cannot really be defined. I quite understand, I think, looking backwards through history and upwards to this time and moment, I want to suggest that the Nigerian economy has never been so tested by so many variables, and including those variables that are probably out of the capacity of our government to handle efficiently. However, a lot of the challenges that we are seeing have only compounded because some of the very fundamental things that we need to do from 1960 upwards, we have not done them. What I mean by those is those economic decisions that we need to do, and those issues, those economic matters that we have to implement and get them to work. As a nation, from the day we became independent and up till this time, it still remains a rhetoric in the cycle of government. Every government that comes will tell you what it will do. In the final analysis, you cannot practically differentiate between which other government and the other government, and whichever political party and which other political party. The political elites actually have not delivered what we expect in this country, and they need to do more. Need to do more in the sense that given this massive economic hemorrhage that Nigeria has witnessed from the recession registered in 2016 upwards, and the efforts of the government to stabilize the economy, and then immediately the economy began to grow, we now have the COVID-induced economic crisis which has taken over the world and which is still actually stifling reasonable and strong recovery of the global economy. And you know, the Nigerian economy, being a monocultural economy, depends almost for 80% of its foreign reserves, foreign exchange income, from one single product that is the most volatile product in the global economy. And so, if you look at all these landscapes, well, I would suggest, yes, that there is hope, because God has actually blessed Nigeria beyond what words can say. In the entire African continent, the position where Nigeria is positioned is the most endowed. If you look at it, if you look at the entire African landscape, we have been given and blessed with everything that you need. The human capital, the natural resources beneath the earth, on the surface and in the air. We have been given everything for us to be a great nation. And unfortunately, the political class, every politician that had an opportunity to hold this responsibility or the other, have actually failed to thank God for what he has done to us and make what he has done to us work for us. They have continued to remain more divisive and creating crisis where there is none. And so I want to say, yes, we have everything it takes, the short to medium term, to register growth. And therefore, I would suggest, yes, there is hope in the horizon, and if all our politicians and leaders will work towards attaining that.
Okay, Mr. Rabiu, I would like for you to speak to issues around insecurity. In recent times, we have seen even food baskets of the nations being threatened by insecurity. And of course, there is some causal effect relationship between insecurity and inflation. Can you speak to these issues? Because of course this are very undesirable situations, but we can't run away from the fact that that is what is happening. That is our reality right now. Can you speak to the relationship between insecurity and inflation?
From an economic point of view, the cost of delivering security for us, for farmers, for the cost, what it costs the government to deliver security. And what I mean government across the board, from the federal to the state government and the local government, to get to restore normalcy so that farmers will go and farm and then evacuate and then get markets return back to normal and what have you. I think it's a very enormous cost that the economy is currently absorbing. In fact, nobody can give you at the moment the statistics of how much is government spending to ensure that there is security all over the Nigerian, within the Nigerian border. That nobody can even see. That's one. So it's a very humongous cost on the side of government, cost of governance. Now, getting farmers back to go back to farm, produce, process and distribute, if you look at the entire value chain loss that has been created because of this insecurity, it will tell you clearly that insecurity has a very direct relationship with the ensuing food inflation that we are seeing in this country. If it takes farmers to pay tolls at every security checkpoint, it takes farmers to possibly bribe the kidnappers to enable them to go back to their farms and produce, and it takes community to take extra efforts to protect themselves and then for them to get to indulge in agri-economic activities, produce. All these are costs. Ultimately, a rational investor, a rational businessman will always price that in the ultimate cost of his final produce. And that is why you will see that there is an ensuing food inflation because there is growing insecurity in areas that produce a lot of this, especially the cereal and other agricultural products. In addition to that, the fact that the government has not been stable with its policy on cost of energy, which ultimately affects the cost of transportation and what have you, that equally has created a lot of uncertainty and which has actually been priced in the cost of food at points of delivery, at points where the consumer buys. Now, like I said, it is a combination of actions and inactions of the government that actually create this scenario, which ultimately farm produce and farm agricultural outputs would ultimately be affected, and then ultimately pricing all the entire crisis in the value chain. We believe very much that a stable and secure environment is a positive thing for production and is a positive thing for cost, and is going to be positive for Nigerians.
A stable farming environment is what will be positive, yes, for Nigerians. But are you seeing, yes, any policies at this point that may be pointing towards the direction of a future stable farming environment for Nigerians?
Well, at policy level, I think with every policy, the Nigerian government has every policy that you're looking for to get this country to a great nation. Every policy is there in the document, we are there embedded in the files, in everywhere, everything. We have a security policy, we have almost 1 million uniformed men. Mm-hmm. So budgetary allocations have been given for procurements or security, infrastructure, and what have you. And unfortunately, like I say, policy in itself does not actually deliver the desired result. It is the commitment of the policymakers and the policy implementers, and with the level of seriousness and the highest level of the policy that determine whether the policy works or not. Security policy, we have every institution that you are looking for to give us security. The budgets have been provided. It's all for part of policy. You come down to the community level, yes, everybody wants to be secure. I mean, everybody wants to have a crisis-free environment so that we can operate, produce, distribute, create wealth, and then create prosperity for the economy. Now, the emphasis should be on the commitment and seriousness of the policy implementers, and then those at the highest level of the policy that usually should constitutionally ensure that these policies are implemented. We are never deficient of policy in this country. What we are deficient for is the institutions that are supposed to implement, the people that are supposed to implement, and then the instruments that we are supposed to implement. That is what has remained deficient all through the history of this country.
Okay, Mr. Rabiu, I'll take you back to the latest CPI data, that is the Consumer Price Index from the National Bureau of Statistics. And that report showed that the composite food index rose by 22.72% in the month of April from 15.02%. In the month of April last year, that is year on year, we have seen a rising of over 7%. And the rise in food index was caused mostly by coffee, tea, cocoa, bread, cereal, soft drinks, milk, cheese, egg, vegetables, meat, oil, fat, fish, and potato, as well as yam. I am just curious, Mr. Rabiu, why can you give us a breakdown as to why this particular product had the highest increases in price?
Thank you very much. Anytime the National Bureau of Statistics come with this kind of records, I usually look at the particular product. One that is very interesting to me is the cheese component of the inflation index. Now, I don't see cheese as one of the things that I don't even see it on the counters in supermarkets and what have you. I don't know why they usually come with these numbers. But however, having said that, yes, unfortunately, this rate has never been attained in the last 15 years. I think the last time we have witnessed a surging and high rate of inflation was somewhere in 2006 or thereabout. Now, if you're talking about 15 years, I usually say there is the seasonal component of the inflation, and then there is the structural component. The structural component is that whenever the prices of inputs, cost of transportation, cost of logistics, there is an entire increase in the value chain cost, and there is no way the ultimate cost of food price would not increase. That's one. The seasonal component is that around the season, usually say at the inset of the rainy season, there is a traditional rise in food prices because of the fact that most of the reserves have been exhausted, and then there is pressure on the existing few reserves that is left with people, and therefore that is generally induced because of the demand and supply issues. But however, like you have pointed, this rate has never been attained in the last 15 years. And that clearly suggests there is so many other factors which hitherto did not exist and which are now putting so much pressure on the system for it to price agricultural produce at this humongous rate. Now, I quite agree the rates are very high and they are unhealthy, and that government should at this time, if it has the reserves at all, if the reserves are there at all, this is the best time you see food reserves being brought out to stabilize prices. whether we have the reserves yet. We have any reserves in our various reserve facilities that we can see around. My belief is that there is none. It has only remained, they have only remained warehouses for the sake of having warehouses. And therefore, I want to call on the government to please arrange and do all the necessary things, even if it includes getting some of these products imported at this very critical time, so that the stability that is needed in the prices of food and food products should be made available to the public, especially at this very critical time.
Okay, Mr. Rabiu, just before we go, what would you say is the best hedge against inflation right now? And what turnaround mechanism can the private sector put in place at a time such as now, and especially since we've seen some number of interventions come from the government and it does not seem to be enough? What role can the private sector play, and what is the best hedge against inflation right now?
Now, the private sector, you mean the private sector or the public sector?
The private sector.
Yeah. You see, the private sector in any country or any developing or growing nation, and even in developed nations, work when the environment is made appropriate for them to invest. Now, let me give you a very small example. At the inset of this administration in 2015, 2016, we only had less than 5 medium-sized operating rice mills in this country. Less than 5. In fact, the biggest of them had the capacity to produce 100,000 tons per annum. Now, when the government came and saw that there was need to put some inducement for the private sector to invest, all those inducements were made. And then before you say it, I can comfortably tell you that within the period between then till now, we have rice mills spread all over the country of various sizes. In fact, the internal capacity to mill rice, as I'm speaking to you, is now somewhere in the realm of 40-50% of what we locally produce. Now, see, because incentives have been put and then the appropriate environment has been created. Now, if the government will create an appropriate environment, an appropriate environment means a secure environment in terms of physical security and fiscal incentives for people that will venture into the sector, and then putting some structured financing, not necessarily budget reallocation, structured financing to get big time farmers access finance to produce at large scale. All these things can be done in Nigeria. So many of the efforts done by previous other administrations have been done, but the quantity of output has not so far been commensurate with the total amount of budgetary investment in some of these interventions. And that tells you clearly that there's a problem somewhere. Now, the intervention efficiency in most of the programs of government have always been suboptimal. Suboptimal in the sense that when you compare the billions and the billions of naira that the government is said to have spent, and then the ultimate outputs in terms of contribution of the various interventions to the GDP, you will see that basically the per unit cost of output, I mean, for every 1 million naira that the government spent by providing incentive, either economic or financial incentive into a productive area, you find that the ultimate output is not commensurate with what the government has put. And that is to question the intervention and implementation efficiency. Why a government set aside 1 billion, possibly 600 million, will go to actually oil the apparatus of government that we implement. They buy good vehicles, buy good office furniture, and the ultimate analysis may be matters. That is why intervention efficiency and implementation efficiency must have to be looked at any time any government is embarking on any program. Do you know, I come across a statistic that say it cost the Nigerian government almost 1 million naira to create one additional job in the economy. And you ask, where are the jobs? And they are not there. Trillions and trillions of naira between both public institutions and then public development finance institutions are going into the name of empowering MSMEs, empowering people to get jobs. But in the final analysis, the quantum of job that is created, when you divide it, you will see that the government is spending almost a million naira in oiling the infrastructure that will create the job. And in the final analysis, one job will be created out of 1 million. And unfortunately, this has remained persistent over time, and that nobody seems to really bother about that. And policy makers and policy implementers will gather around the table, take coffee and biscuits and tea. And then the news media will broadcast that something has been done. And in the final, if you then go down to the grassroots, you ultimately might not see what would be commensurate to the quantum of resources that has been mobilized to create those economic impetus.
Thank you, Mr. Rabiu Hassan Tuko, for joining us on Cosmopolitan Market.
Thank you very much, Madia.
Thank you. I have been speaking with Rabiu Hassan Tuko. He is an economist, and we have been speaking to issues around food security. How far has it been so far, especially with the fight against food insecurity in Nigeria? And is there a food crisis looming? I mean, that is the question on the lips of many Nigerians, and we have seen food baskets of the nation being threatened by food insecurity. What is the way out? And we have been able to address some of these issues, how we can have these policies beyond papers and take actually actionable decisions that will bring close to the food crisis that Nigeria just might be experiencing. And that's the much that we can take into this edition of the program and Cosmopolitan Market. We'll be back with you tomorrow by 11 a.m. to keep you updated on happenings in the world of business, commerce, finance, investment, not forgetting the economy. I am Chiamaka Inendu. Thank you for watching, and bye for now.